Justice and Associate Justice of the Supreme Court of California. Hear ye, hear ye, hear ye. The Honorable Supreme Court sitting en banc is now in session. Please be seated.
Good morning. Welcome to oral argument. Before I have the clerk call the calendar, we'd like to welcome some of our visitors in the courtroom and in the overflow auditorium at the lower level. A group of international students from the University of San Francisco with Professor Lonnie Verotsko. Are you here in this room? Welcome. We also welcome the moot court class from the University of San Francisco, Professor Amy Flynn. Good morning. And the immigration law class from UC Hastings, Professor Richard Boswell. Welcome. Clerk may call the calendar.
May it please the court, I'm James Wagstaff, appearing on behalf of the Committee of Bar Examiners of the State Bar of California. This case raises the ever-vital question whether there is or should be a rule requiring the blanket screening and rejection of bar applicants solely on the basis of their immigration status.
Mr. Wagstaff, as I see it, the important issue before the court pertains to a federal statute. And I think it's section 1621 of, US Code. And I presume that eventually in the course of your argument to this court, you would focus on certain phrases in that particular provision. First of all, let's make it easy. Generally, what does this particular federal statute prohibit?
What this federal statute prohibits, Your Honor, actually is allowed, of course, because the statute itself allows states to enact laws. But as to situations where the law is not enacted, Your Honor, it says that states shall not give public benefits that are of a particular type, including professional licenses, that are provided by an agency of the state or by appropriated funds. Those are our terms that we're looking at.
And I presume that initially you're going to focus on an agency of the state.
Well, I am, Your Honor. But perhaps I should start with that very, how do we read the statute? Because it's a statute by which is attempting to take away existing police power, we have to ask ourselves whether a federal statute can be read to take away long existing plenary power in the absence of clear and manifest language. That's the prism through which we analyze
the
statute.
Just to unclear my personal confusion, would you be kind enough to explain to me? In reading the statute, the federal statute, 1621, it does allow the state to do something contrary to that federal statute. Is my construction correct?
It is, Your Honor.
All right, next question.
That's why people have called this an authorizing statute.
Next question.
Yes, Your Honor.
Can you point to any particular California legislative act that goes completely contrary to the federal statute and does allow what you are asking this court to allow?
As to a legislative act, Your Honor, I cannot. I can simply say, however, that the statute uses the word law, not statute. Law, of course, I teach civil procedure, first day of class.
So?
What a law? A law can be, of course.
So we can make up the law.
You can, Your Honor.
Mr. Wagstaff?
Really?
Mr. Wagstaff, let me ask you. We're here to decide congressional intent.
Yes, Your Honor.
Of a 1996 statute contained in an act, in a portion of the act called Restricting Welfare and Public Benefits for Aliens, end quote. And just so we're clear, we're talking about 1621 1CA, and that whole statute of 1621 expressly denies public benefits from certain, quote-unquote, language of the statute, aliens. And that includes public benefits under A, C1A, and C1B. But the one we're concerned about today is whether or not a license, professional license, is prohibited. And it's clear that the statute prohibits professional licenses provided by a state agency, that's one prong, or professional licenses by appropriated state funds. Are we on the same page here for what we're
you
doing
are,
here?
Yes, we are, Your Honor.
So why is it that this statute does it preclude us from granting the license here?
Thank you, Your Honor. Section 1621 does not, as is required, clearly and manifestly displace this court's long-established plenary power to license lawyers. And if I may explain. Since the founding of the Republic, the power to license lawyers rests with state courts. No question about that. It's the core sovereign power of states. And the Supreme Court and this Court of Martinez has told us, when we look at a federal statute to see whether they intended to take away core power, we ask ourselves, did they do so in manifest and express terms through, in the language of the Supreme Court, unmistakably clear language, a plain statement?
What's not clear in this statute, which provides that aliens or non-immigrants not documented are not eligible for any state benefit, including a professional license? What is not clear there?
It has two qualifications, Your Honor. First, it is only if the license is provided by an agency. Let's start with that one.
All right.
Agency. Agency, I think no one here is arguing that the Supreme Court of the state of California is an agency.
Ah, wait a minute. That's an interesting issue that you raise.
Okay.
And again, I need clarification from you and, of course, from the other attorneys who will be at the podium. What you do have in support of your position is, I'm trying to find the particular case that you refer to in your briefs, where you point out that the word agency, when one takes a look at other federal statutes, does not include the courts and is limited to the executive at branch administrative agencies. Right so far?
Yes, Your Honor.
Ah, but
And the Supreme Court has told us that in the Hubbard decision.
Yes, Hubbard, 1995 decision.
Yes.
And there's also a federal statutory provision, 5 U.S.C. section 551, defining agency for purposes of the Federal Administrative Procedure Act to exclude federal courts. Fine so far. You've got that on your side. But then we take a look at other sources. And it appears that 22 U.S.C. section 6106 1 says the term agency of the United States government includes any court of the judicial branch. And taking a look at California law, Government Code Section 3202, the term state agency includes every state office, department, division, bureau, board, commission, superior court, court of appeal, and the Supreme Court. My approach, and this is, I'm just talking about my view, which may be completely wrong, and that's why the attorneys are here to correct me. It would appear that given the ambiguity as to what the word agency means, as used in Section 1621 of the Federal Statute, there appears to be ambiguity. Once there is ambiguity, we apply well-established rules of statutory construction. We then have to figure out what was congressional intent in this particular instance. And I presume we can then also take a look at the legislative history pertaining to the eventual enactment of the statute here. And what was the purpose that Congress had in mind when it enacted Section 1621?
Your Honor, 1601, which is the lead-in.
1621,
Your Honor. I think with respect to the definition of agency, this Court has told us repeatedly you use
the... I'm talking about the purpose. Would we correct to say that when one takes a look at what may have been behind the congressional intent is the restriction of the availability of public benefits to those people who are not lawfully here, thus presumably reducing the incentive to come into the United States unlawfully? Is that, I'm trying to figure out what the purpose was of Congress.
The first word of the purpose section, 1601, is self-sufficiency. Is the government funding the benefit? Is it through funding the benefit? In this case, of course, the facts show that the government is not funding the benefit because the
well, you're skipping to the second prong at this point.
I was asked about the purpose of the statute, but if I could, the usual and ordinary meaning of agency does not include courts.
Mr. Wagstaff, if you will forgive me for interrupting you, what is the general purpose, or what was the general purpose behind the congressional intent? At this point, I am not focusing on agency. That is afterwards.
The purpose of the statute is as written, is if a benefit is provided by an agency or if the benefit is provided by the appropriation. That's the purpose of the statute, designed to encourage self-reliance of those who are undocumented immigrants.
I have a couple questions.
Please, Your Honor.
First of all, congressional intent is paramount in this case.
It is, Your Honor.
And is there anything in the history, the congressional history, that would indicate that Congress wanted to parcel out a license to practice law as opposed to a license to practice medicine, a license to conduct nursing services, a license to teach? Is there anything at all that you can point to that would indicate that Congress felt that a license to practice law should be treated differently?
Yes, Your Honor. Because of the manner in which the Congress knows and this Court and the Supreme Court of the United States have said we interpret laws, you don't assume a law applies to a lawyer if it's taking away sovereign power from the state, such as licensing. Congress must be express in saying it. So were they? I've been carrying this statute around for some weeks. It says of an agency, it could have easily said, and of a court, a license provided by a court.
Well, I'm talking about specific language. I mean, you know, we can look at the term agency and argue whether that covers courts or not. I'm raising the issue of whether there's any congressional history, legislative history, that sets aside a law license in a separate category from any other type of professional license.
Your Honor, there's no legislative history either way, and I think that answer then informs us.
Well, let me stop.
Of course.
You answered Justice Baxter's question that there isn't any express language. But you also, when quoting the national policy on immigration contained in the Section 1601, it also contains a provision that says, it continues to be the immigration policy of the U.S. that aliens within the national borders not depend on public resources to meet their needs, but rather rely on their own capabilities and the resources of their families and private organizations. That's what it says, does it not?
It does,
Your
Honor.
In the language of intent in Section 1601.
It does, Your Honor.
So how does that statement by Congress that aliens within our borders be self-reliant, but rely on families, capabilities, their own resources, and private organizations as opposed to the judicial branch?
Because, Your Honor, we start, that of course is one of the purposes, to encourage self-reliance, to not take tax dollars to pay for somebody's
right.
monetary benefits. In this case, of course, because it's self-funded, we don't have that. But if I may, if we have to read the statute and its words through the prism of reading preemption and supremacy clause statutes. We don't ask ourselves, did they mean to exclude lawyers? That's not the law. The law is, if it's state sovereign power, we ask ourselves, did they mean to include lawyers?
Mr. Wagstaff?
Yes, Your Honor.
I want to take you back, before we get so far away from it that everyone has forgotten it, the answer to what I thought your answer to Justice Corrigan's question was, we, meaning this court, get to make up the law. Did you really say that?
No, Your Honor, I didn't say make up the law. I said that Subdivision D authorizes states to provide benefits if Subdivision C applies, which, as Your Honor knows from our briefing and my argument, we believe it does not, because it does not expressly identify professionals, and I can go there. But as to D, Your Honor, it says the state can have enactment of law. One of two things happens. Either they meant...
Has there been any enactment of law in California that governs this case?
There has not been, Your Honor, until today. And I say that because enactment of a law, if Congress meant to include law licenses in C, which we believe it clearly did not because historically they didn't reference courts.
So your answer is no?
The answer is that...
Until today?
If there's a requirement that we get to D...
Who is acting?
This court would be acting, as it has throughout... I've been in this court several times where the court has created rules of court in the case itself, as it's permitted to do.
Do we commonly refer to that action as enacting a law?
Well, Your Honor, that's the glory of the computer. Many times, actually. Courts across the country have said when you...
Have we ever done that?
Excuse
me? Got one from California?
The Warden decision, Justice Kennard in dissent, talks about laws create from many sources. The Justice O'Connor and McFarland talks about enacting
creative,
rules.
I wouldn't doubt or disagree with you for a moment that this court articulates the common law. It is one of the wonders of Anglo-American jurisprudence. I'm wondering whether or not anyone has referred to that creation of the common law as an enactment of the law.
Your Honor, no, but when this court makes policy determinations on rules, it is, of course, acting in its legislative capacity.
That's Mr. Wagstaff,
yes,
do you agree with me? Two questions. Do you agree with me that 1621D, when it talks about enactment of a state law, is a bit ambiguous? So first question, why is the judicial branch not a state agency when we're in 1621C1A, but we are one in 1621 paren D? That's my first question.
Okay.
And my second question is, given the ambiguity, the House Conference Report on this case, on this statute, says that no decision of any state or federal court shall provide a sufficient basis for a state to be relieved of the requirement to deny benefits to illegal aliens, end quote.
So first, Your Honor, the first question, which is the anomaly. The anomaly, if the courts are somehow covered by C, and I submit they are not for the reasons in our brief, and if I get to it, then it would make no sense to have a savings clause that allows a state to do it, but the one public benefit, that is the law license, which this court provides, no one else provides it but this court, that's the one item that's excluded from D. That makes no sense. It's an anomaly. That would be, in many ways, simply a gaping hole.
It's not anomalous, counsel. I mean, the statute is written to say state legislature's enactment because perhaps Congress wanted political accountability. They wanted, if a state is going to license undocumented immigrants to do law, medicine, whatever, they wanted it to occur through a politically accountable mechanism. Courts typically don't have that kind of political accountability, and so they chose specifically the instrument of the state legislature to ensure that political accountability. Why isn't that the most straightforward reading of the statute?
I don't think it is, Your Honor, because the core sovereign power on law licenses is this court. It's not the legislature.
I understand that, but of course our legislature has legislated on the practice of law in lots of different ways. And if the legislature were to pass a law that said, you know, we think undocumented immigrants should be allowed to be evaluated for a law license irrespective of their immigration status. And, of course, if this court were inclined to agree with the legislature, we would simply defer to that statute. There would be no problem with that.
Your Honor's phrasing.
Congress is not saying that the legislature of a state must be authorized to license people. It just says the legislature has to express that is agreeable to them.
But subdivision D talks about the state providing the benefit. And in this case, Your Honor, the only body, the only sovereign body with core sovereign power that can do so is this court. This court has on occasion used the aid of the legislature, but on repeated occasions, the Merco case, in re attorney discipline, etc., this court has said the plenary and exclusive power to issue law licenses and to regulate the practice of law is in this court, not the legislature.
Except, Mr. Wagstaff, that of course there is something else drifting out there which says that while you are right that, yes, we ordinarily do have that power, but the federal government has the plenary authority over matters relating to immigrations. And at least as I understand it, provisions of federal law regarding immigration may well preempt or do preempt state law. And getting to the subdivision D provision, if my recollection is correct, you pointed out to the court, after acknowledging on your part that California's legislature has not enacted a law overriding the prohibition in the federal statute, which is 1621, you, in answer to, I think, a question by Justice Chin, pointed out, but as of today, California has done so. As of today, you and we are in court. And what hasn't changed is that the legislature of California has taken no steps to override the federal statute. And taking a look at subdivision D, it specifically talks about the state overriding, et cetera, and enactment by the state. Are you still taking the view that, look, that doesn't mean much, even though the court is not the legislature, it can do so because the court does issue licenses. But then, of course, you get back to the point that I raised, Congress has plenary authority over immigration issues.
Mr. Wagstaff, you may answer the question. Your time's expired.
You'll
have 2 minutes
for
rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. Your Honor, the plenary authority of Congress over immigration has been addressed by this court in Martinez, which says in this statute, we read the statute's terms. So we're not talking about immigration incurring here. This statute's terms says if the license is provided by an agency, this court is not an agency, and the Congress could have easily included those words and did not. The plenary authority of this court cannot be taken away by accident or surprise or it has to be clearly and manifestly. So all we're left with is that somehow this court's salaries and the overhead are paid as appropriations, and therefore somehow that must mean the statute takes away the police power. Let me suggest that that is an Escher painting, not clear and unmistaken, because this court, while it receives general appropriated funds as overhead and salaries, this court does not, that the appropriations are not licensing lawyers, this court is licensing lawyers, and therefore, subdivision C does not apply to professional licenses because the law says if you're going to take away a court's plenary authority, you must do so unmistakably, not through accidental interpretations of a word appropriation, that statute does not apply to the licensing of lawyers, and therefore the interesting issues of enactment do not need to be reached.
Thank you, Mr. Wagstaff. 2 minutes on rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. Jerome Fishkin on behalf of Sergio Garcia. We submit to the court that Business and Professions Code Section 6060.6 is indeed the statute that you've been asking about, and that's because that statute expressly permits somebody who is ineligible for a Social Security number to apply to be a lawyer and be licensed as a lawyer using something other than a Social Security number. And by definition, as far as I can tell, and as we have briefed and some of the amicus have briefed, is the only group of people that fits under that code section are immigrants who don't have green cards or perhaps work permits. And therefore, that is, if a statute is needed, that is the statute that does so.
So it's your view that that statute relating to eligibility for Social Security benefits is a statute that satisfies the requirement that the state provide through the enactment of a state law which affirmatively provides for the eligibility of an unlawful immigrant?
Yes, Your Honor. Would also like to reiterate what was said here that law licenses are different under preemption analysis, under federal preemption analysis. We start generally with the premise in preemption that we first look at the language of the statute, but the preemption analysis requires us also to look at the entire statutory scheme. And the case law has told us clearly that lawyers and law licenses are different, and if there's an intent to license for a preemption statute to preempt this court's ability to admit or discipline attorneys, it must
be. So, Mr. Fishkin, under that analysis, then if we look at 1621 C1 A and B, and if the argument carries the day that the Supreme Court is not covered under 1621 C to prohibit benefits, then I suppose it means that the Supreme Court can give grants, contracts, loans, commercial licenses, retirement, welfare, health, disability benefits, public or assisted housing benefits, educational benefits, food assistance, unemployment benefits, and any other similar benefit to, as the statute calls, aliens. Is that right?
We would be
completely exempt, and the Supreme Court could start granting loans and contracts because this law doesn't apply to us.
Wow, are we going to be busy?
That's not what we're saying.
Well, then are you only singling out professional license? Because that seems to be your argument. We're focused on professional license, but if the Supreme Court is not considered either an agency or considered appropriated funds, then we're completely out of this statute and we can give whatever we want. Isn't that the logical conclusion of your argument?
No, I don't think so. I think it means this court can admit lawyers, this court can discipline lawyers, this court without reference to that statute can do as you did in the attorney discipline case and impose dues on lawyers. The other powers that you read from the statute are not powers that would typically be administered by the Supreme Court.
Well, that's not necessarily true. The courts themselves may engage in grants or contracts, disability benefits, retirement benefits, health benefits. That's what we do. We have employees here. That's what we do.
I would have to come back to where I would support what Mr. Wagstaff said, and that is we're concentrated here on the professional license, and that when the federal government is going to take away the power to discipline or the power to admit lawyers, it must do so expressly and not by implication, and it hasn't done so here.
Well, so is your position that if they wanted to include law licenses, saying professional licenses isn't enough, they should say law licenses and medical licenses and barber's licenses and fishing licenses and whatever other kind of licenses might fall into that category? Because if they don't enumerate them, the umbrella professional licenses is not sufficient?
No, what we're saying is that because law licenses uniquely come from the judicial branch of the government and not elsewhere, that it's the law license that must be specified, and the failure to specify the law license.
So the doctors would be out of luck and the barbers would be out of luck, but the lawyers, they have to be specifically articulated.
lawyers have to be specifically articulated. I think we have briefed that issue. I think several of the amicus have.
So would this statute otherwise apply to physicians, for example, who are also licensed by the state?
I assume so, because number one, physicians are not licensed by the judicial branch of the government, and that's where we think the distinction is.
Doesn't that seem like an odd result to interpret the statute that way when they use a universal term? And most people, when they think about professional licenses, if you're not in a profession that's otherwise licensed, the average person thinks of doctors and lawyers, don't they?
I think the average person probably thinks of doctors and lawyers and a couple of others and gives no thought to the fact that lawyers are licensed from the judicial branch of the government by the inherent power of this court, and doctors are not, and dentists are not, and cosmetologists are
not. Counsel, what do you think the appropriate funds language in C means?
I think appropriate.
What does it mean to have a license provided by appropriated funds?
I would envision something like the medical board, where the government provides funds to an agency, and those funds are used to provide the license. Without the medical board,
I mean, there is no literal meaning of the phrase in the sense that the funds aren't providing the license in any case. I mean, some entity is providing the license, is it not?
Well,
I mean, in other words, you have to read that language commonsensically to mean provided by an entity supported by appropriated funds. Doesn't it have to mean that?
No, it can mean, for instance.
Do funds go around walking by themselves, handing out licenses? No, entities do, right? Entities do, and entities are supported by the funds.
In federal legislative process, laws authorize entities, laws authorize programs, but there's also a separate appropriation for them. In the absence of the appropriation.
Okay, so now we're at a different point in the argument. You're saying it must be a separate appropriation. Why? That's not in the language of the statute.
It says the use of appropriated funds, and I will agree with Mr. Wagstaff that the appropriated funds do not provide the license. It's the inherent and plenary power of this court that exists whether or not there are appropriated funds. The legislature does not appropriate funds for this court next year. This court still has the power to license attorneys. If the legislature appropriate funds and the controller doesn't cut the checks, this court has the inherent power to license attorneys. It's not the appropriate.
Do you also agree with Mr. Wagstaff that this court should enact a new law? And in enacting that new law, we should use the policy considerations that you have urged?
I agree that this court has the power. I believe that's what you did in the In Re Attorney Discipline case, is created a rule of court to assess dues on lawyers based on an OSC or based on a hearing in a case, and that it was a Supreme Court rule, and that's part of the Supreme Court's what's sometimes referred to as the legislative side of a court, where the court enacts rules. It would fit within or without this statute because.
And while we're considering these policy considerations, can you tell me whether or not the record has any contrary considerations? In other words, did the amicus from the U.S. Department of Justice provide any contrary policy considerations, or did they just urge us to examine the language of the statute?
I think I don't want to speak for the Department of Justice. My recollection is that in the three amicus briefs that were filed in opposition, they focused on such issues as, is this court an agency? Did the enactment intend to discourage immigration or to discourage undocumented immigrants? I think the issue was discussed. How do you discourage a child from following his parents to the country of his choice? This is where family values and legal values intersect.
Mr. Fishkin, you say that 60.6 is the affirmative statute that permits undocumented immigrants to obtain a law license.
Yes, Your Honor.
Putting that aside, the underlying argument, though, I take you agree with this, and that is that 1621 subdivision D is kind of a savings clause, so to speak. There are multiple prohibitions in 1621 about public benefits for, as the statute quotes, aliens, including a professional license. But when you read through the statute and you get to 1621D, it provides specifically that the state may provide for an alien, as described in the statute, to be eligible for any state or local benefit for which the alien would otherwise be ineligible only through the enactment of a state law, which affirmatively provides for such eligibility. So would you agree then that notwithstanding the interpretation of the statute thus far as argued amongst the parties, that clearly the legislature has authority to do and enact an affirmative law that permits a law license, much the same way as we found in Martinez with the education code?
Yes, the legislature has that authority, I agree. That to the extent there's an ambiguity in all of this, ambiguity is one of those things that factors in the analysis that 1621C does not apply. And it's the ambiguity dealing with lawyers who are licensed by the judicial branch, by this court, not even by the judicial branch, by this court. And that's what makes lawyers different, and that's why 1621C.
Can I return you then, counsel, to the appropriated funds language? I mean, I guess I'm not seeing the ambiguity you see. You want to read that to have some additional words, meaning you would add the words specifically appropriated, you know, for the purpose of providing licenses.
No,
that is not what the statute says. It just says appropriated funds. This is a our court operates on appropriated funds. You said, I mean, these two parts of your argument are actually in tension. You say the court is not an agency. The court is the one providing the licenses. That gets you out of the first prong. I'm actually inclined to agree with you on that. The court is not an agency. But the minute you say that, you have to acknowledge that the court is the one providing licenses, and the court is an entity supported by appropriated funds.
It is definitely supported by appropriated funds, and those appropriated funds make it easier and far more convenient to do the job of a court.
Indeed, necessary.
I disagree. If all the appropriated funds were taken away from this court would still have the power to be a Supreme Court and hear cases and issue orders. And it would not depend upon whether or not somebody basically cut the picture.
We could do it with the lights off and the heat turned down, but I mean, it wouldn't really be a court.
It would be a court. It would be a whole lot of problems, but it. You know,
I mean, look, by the time we're getting into these somewhat extreme hypotheticals, yep. Don't you think you've strayed from the plain reading of the statute?
The plain language of the statute is the first question, but not the last question.
Mr. Fishkin, I'm sorry, your time's expired.
Thank you.
Good morning. May it please the court. We believe that Section 1621C does not prohibit this court from.
Counsel, your brief says that you think that 1621 is, I'm using your words, qualified, right? You think it's a limited proscription.
Yes.
Other than the law license, in what sense is it limited?
When we say that it's qualified, when you look at Subdivision C, they could have stopped after the word commercial license. And prohibited any grant, contract, loan, professional, or commercial license, period.
That's true, but your brief contains not a single example of anything else you think is exempt from this prohibition other than the law license.
Well, we're not aware of anything else that is exempt.
So it's not much of a limitation, is my point.
My point is that words follow the word license, professional license, and there are two qualifications. The first one is this agency qualification. And the second one is provided by appropriated funds. And what we have argued is that because of the inherent power of courts to admit attorneys, the cases say that unless the Congress either writes something that applies to every person and is over-inclusive or is very specific and goes right at the heart of the matter and talks about courts or attorneys, then it is not attempting to regulate those functions.
I think it's not a bad argument, but my point is that, okay, so you have the word professional license, which you have to concede, I think, that ordinarily, in ordinary parlance, if you just see that word, it's doctors and lawyers, like Justice Corrigan said. Now, your claim is that the lawyer part of the doctors and lawyers, the commonsensical reading, is excised from the statute by these qualifications, state agency and appropriated funds. I'm asking, if you think those are qualifications, right, on the proscription, is there anything else other than law licenses that are excised from the common sense reading of these of the term professional license, or for that matter, grants, contracts, or loans?
Well,
so it's a set of one. The exception is a set of one, and it happens to be the one you're arguing for.
As far as I'm concerned, that's fine. And the reason is because we exist in a world where your power is plenary in this area. And what we ask is, did Congress intend to control you? That is the question,
as
I see it.
That's a very entertaining argument designed to make us feel good. By golly, Congress can't control us. But Congress used a very broad term, professional licenses. It does happen to be the case in this state, and as far as I know, all the other states, that the Supreme Court is the ultimate issuer of the license. But don't you think it would seem odd if they really wanted to say we mean all other licenses, doctors and dentists and beauticians and all those other people who are licensed, except lawyers, they could have said that.
It's actually the other way around, Your Honor. And that's what the cases that we cited say. The Federal Trade Communication case, where the Federal Trade Communication said we have a right to regulate attorney conduct because there's this broad statute that controls the way certain financial transactions occur. And we know that lawyers are involved in those, and so therefore clearly...
But that was a far more ambiguous statute. I mean, the statutory term in that case was financial institutions, was it not?
It was financial institutions.
I mean, it's not a professional license, you know, commonsensically means lawyers and doctors. Financial institutions doesn't even come close.
So my answer to that would be that the statute does not say that you cannot have professional licenses. There are all these words that follow. So if they intended to simply block all professional licenses, they could have put a period there, and then we wouldn't be advancing this argument.
Well, no, they perhaps permitted situations where private entities do the licensing with no complicity by the state. Those are left out of the equation. Everybody agrees with that, I think.
None of the words that follow relate to that, Your Honor. The words that
well, that's
follow.
The very point, is that after one of the other counsel mentioned that the purposes of the statute were to encourage reliance on either self-sufficiency or reliance on private organizations.
Who's more self-sufficient than Mr. Garcia?
I concede that. That's not the point. The point is that there are other, you said if they put a period after professional license, we'd be done. No, we wouldn't be done, because the Congress specifically wanted to remove from eligibility the licenses that were provided by the state in some way, either by agencies or by entities supported by the state. It was the state complicity in the license that they were after. Isn't that the plainest reading of the statute?
With respect, I submit no. And the construction that you were advancing in questions to my brothers was that the first clause stands for agency, and then the second one, because it's appropriated funds, also stands for agency, essentially. And to me, that would mean that there's much surplusage in this statute. And that's not the way that we construe a statute.
Counsel, let me ask you this question. It seems to me Congress, in passing 1621, extended an open invitation to the states to enact legislation to permit undocumented residents to be licensed, to be licensed in a variety of ways. And I'm troubled, or not, I shouldn't say I'm troubled, I'm curious as to why the legislature has not taken up that invitation. Do you happen to know? Has there been an attempt through the legislative process to not only focus on lawyers, but also to focus on doctors and nurses and teachers and a variety of other professionals that are in need?
I can't answer that question. I will say that this is a dynamic field. We've seen a lot of changes. We've seen the DREAM Act recently. We've seen this court's decision in Martinez. You know, this is
I would think that there's a lot of public support for this. I don't know. I certainly haven't taken any polls, but it seems to me it's a classic case where the political process could achieve a lot more than any attempt to ask this court to legislate.
Well, I'm not asking this court to legislate. I'm not participating in the 1621D argument.
So you aren't endorsing Mr. Wagstaff, your brother, Mr. Wagstaff's argument?
We have not advanced that argument.
How about Mr. Fishkin's argument that 60.6 is the can enable us to get there?
I think 60.6 is relevant to one of the questions advanced by the court, that you should definitely divide the issue of admission versus employability. I think that statute's relevant to that.
I have a question. Oh, sorry for interrupting you. I was just concerned that your time may soon be running out. And if you will allow me to ask you a question at this point, would you?
Yes.
All right. Thank you very much. I'm intrigued by the 60.6 argument. And if I were on the attorney side, I would rely on that too. So I have questions on that. Is it correct to say that that particular provision allows a person seeking to be admitted to the practice of law in California to submit a federal tax ID number instead of a social security number, right so far?
That's right.
And you may recall that Mr. Fishkin argued, well, when you take a look at that statute and the provision relating to inability to provide a social security number, the category of people falling into that class would be persons who are residents here but lack the requisite documentation. At first glance, that has some appeal, but then in taking a much, much closer look at that and rereading the provision several times, it would appear from 1621D, and now I'm flipping to the federal statute, it limits the particular exemption that we've been talking about to affirmatively providing. How is affirmatively providing satisfied here? One would have to deduce from, well, those who are not here on a legal basis would not be eligible for Social Security benefits. Therefore, blah, 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 blah. Does that satisfy the affirmatively provide requirement that Congress has put in its federal statute? There isn't one reference to residents who are not lawfully here.
I agree that that's a weakness in the argument. And that's why I rely on 60.6. It's merely to point out that immigration status should not...
But that's what I've been talking about. Am I missing something? My question to you pertains to 60.6.
We're not arguing a D exemption. We have not attempted to find either that statute or the inherent power of what this court can do after this argument to satisfy D. We're strictly arguing C, and I'm hoping that if...
Oh, because you see a weakness in the other argument, and so you're not joining your brethren.
I will not disparage their arguments, but I will acknowledge that I'm not advancing them.
Mr. Moody, your time's expired.
Thank you.
Thank you.
May it please the court, I'm Daniel Tenney from the United States.
Mr. Tenney, would you be so kind as to shed light on a question I have, which is one of the issues raised by the opposing side? And you probably still remember the discussion of the particular issues and the reference to state law, particularly Business and Professions Code, Section 60.6, which says, by the way, if you can't provide a Social Security number, you can just give your federal tax ID number. You remember that part?
Yes.
Do you also remember the argument on the opposing side that the reference to not having a social security number must mean that it refers to people who are residents but not lawfully here.
Well, the language, some of the other briefs on the other side, in the case the state bar brief, I believe, describes that provision as one applicable, for example, to foreign students who don't have work authorization, who may come to the United States to study law but not plan to work in the United States, and they wouldn't necessarily be eligible for Social Security numbers, and the legislature has determined that such individuals should be able to become
so
members of the
bar. So it doesn't isn't necessarily limited to a category of people as Mr. Garcia here.
I don't know that it would be fair to describe the statute as affirmatively providing for eligibility for people
because
who are
affirmatively provide is a key phrase, isn't it?
Yes, and also unlawfully present. And the statute doesn't say that people who are unlawfully present in the United States are eligible to
Mr.
receive
Tenney,
these professional licenses.
Has any other state confronted the application of Section 1621, Subdivision C, referencing professional license issued by an agency of a state? Has any other state had occasion to say this does not pertain to licenses to practice law issued by the state Supreme Court?
To my knowledge, no state court has addressed the question. The issue is currently pending before the Florida Supreme Court. And
so it hasn't been decided one way or the other by
correct.
Any state. Is there any state where they have determined without perhaps interpreting that subdivision that the legislature of the state has affirmatively permitted undocumented aliens to be licensed?
With respect to law licenses, mm-hmm. I'm not aware of any such provision. I'm not saying I know for certain that there is none, but I'm not aware of any such provision.
Counsel, can I ask you, supposing you're correct, I've read your brief, supposing you're correct that C applies, I want to return to an argument Mr. Wagstaff made about D, okay? Given that we all agree here that state courts are the ones that issue law licenses, could an enactment of the state legislature provide eligibility for a law license pursuant to D? This is a weird locution, okay? It says, a state may provide that an alien who is not lawfully present is eligible for these otherwise excluded benefits only through the enactment of state law which affirmatively provides for such eligibility. Now, on one reading of it, this is Mr. Wagstaff's argument. On one reading of it, that essentially means that law licenses can never come under D because no such legislation could ever affirmatively provide such eligibility. That is because the plenary power to issue law licenses rests in this court. So, in effect, the statute, 1621D, discriminates against law licenses. In other words, all other kinds of licenses can be affirmatively provided for by the legislature, but not this one.
Well, I'm not sure why that would be the case. The provision that we were just discussing, 6060.6, identifies a category of individuals and makes them eligible to receive law licenses.
No, it doesn't. It says the Committee of Bar Examiners may consider the applicant. That's all it says. Whether or not the applicant is or is not eligible ultimately is up to this court.
I'm a little hesitant to address hypothetical legislation that may be enacted. I suspect, though, that if the legislature enacted a statute saying that such individuals were eligible and this court agreed with that and said that such individuals should be eligible, that would be sufficient to satisfy D. What other circumstances would satisfy D, I'm not in a position to address right now, but it doesn't seem like a hole in the statute in the sense that there's no way that such individuals could be provided licenses. I think that if the legislature and the court together agreed on it at a minimum, that would suffice. And I'm not sure that would be a reason going back to the sort of main issue in the case relating to Section C, Congress in that section was intending to be comprehensive, and it indicated that in several ways.
I think that's possible reading, except that the word only appears in that statute, right? I mean, your argument, which actually was my response to Mr. Wagstaff too, is that, of course, the state Supreme Court could always simply agree with the legislature having enacted such a law. But the statute says only. The state can provide for this eligibility only through the enactment of a state law which affirmatively so provides. Only.
Well, I read the word only there to refer to the converse of the only, meaning the circumstance that's precluded is if in the absence of such an enactment, then a state agency couldn't just go ahead. It's a necessary
but not sufficient condition.
Well, it has to be the case that the agency, whether a court or anyone else, is providing the benefit. You don't sort of, an unlawfully present person wouldn't simply say, there's legislation, and so now I get the benefit. They would have to go through whatever process seemed appropriate to the agency or entity conferring the benefit. And I don't read the statute to change that fundamental aspect of state decision.
Well, but normally speaking, you know, an entity may be providing it, but that entity is not in the same position as the state Supreme Court is with respect to law licenses. Wouldn't you agree? I mean, if California passed a statute that said the Medical Board of California, right, shall consider these applicants, well, the Medical Board of California would be bound by that statute. We, on the other hand, consider the views of the legislature, but we also measure them against our inherent plenary authority to decide who is or is not eligible for the bar.
Well, the existence of discretion of this court with respect to who may or may not be admitted to the bar of this court doesn't seem relevant to the question of whether Congress intended for professional licenses, including law licenses, to be included within the statute at all. You could have a discussion, if there were such an enactment, about the circumstances in which it would override 1621C. It doesn't seem plausible.
It's necessary to reach this, don't you think? Because your construction of the statute is dependent on the notion that C enacts a general prohibition, but there is a kind of federalism outlet in D. And that's the way the statute is kind of in balance, right? General prescription, but an outlet for states to enact exceptions. And that is the balance struck by Congress. I'm asking you, does this balance apply to law licenses? Because if it doesn't, that may suggest that we're not reading the statute correctly.
Right, and I think my answer to one of your earlier questions was that legislation that provided for such eligibility and this court's decision to issue a law license to such a person, we don't think there would be any federal prohibition on the issuance of such a license.
So that is your position.
That would be an outlet if the state enacted such legislation. Whether there are other outlets is not something that we're addressing today.
Mr. Tenney, I want to ask your question about the Supremacy Clause. We've heard a lot today, even now, about this court's plenary authority over admitting applicants, qualified applicants, to practice law in California. But we also have, on the flip side, the federal mandate that Congress has plenary authority to legislate over immigration matters. And so how do you reconcile the two authorities, plenary authority over immigration, which is, as a result, was this statute prohibiting, restricting public benefits, and the state's plenary authority, not the state, the Supreme Court's plenary authority over admission of applicants to practice law in California?
If Congress, as we submit that it has enacted legislation that prohibits the issuance of law licenses to unlawfully present aliens, at least in the circumstances presented here, we would submit that that would control, because Congress, as your question referenced, has plenary authority over immigration matters, and through the Supremacy Clause, if Congress enacts legislation in an area where Congress has authority, then that governs. So our answer to your question really goes back to our conclusion that this provision applies on its face, because a law license is a professional license, because Congress used the term any in front of professional license, because Congress used broad language to cover any issuance of a license by an agency of a state or appropriated funds of a state, which
Mr. Tenney, on that point, I'd like to ask you, there's been discussion whether this court is an agency of the state and whether funds are appropriated for the issuance of a license. What part of the statute, is your view, applies here?
We think that the agency question is a close question, but that the appropriated funds language clearly applies to this court. This court is funded by appropriations, and so when this court issues the license, it's doing so on the basis of having received those appropriated
funds. And the point of agency, would you say that a Supreme Court of a state is not an agency of the government?
We have not taken a position one way or the other. We think that there are reasonable arguments to suggest that it wouldn't be an agency. At the same time, as was discussed to some degree earlier, there are definitions of agency that would cover a court. But the primary point that we're making is that Congress was intending through this language to be comprehensive with respect to the particular types of benefits that were listed in the statute, including professional licenses. And since this court is a recipient of appropriated funds, and that's how it conducts its business, we think that that is the clause that would govern here. But in any event, the statute as a whole, in our view, governs circumstances in which an organ of the state that is funded by appropriated funds issues a professional license to an individual, and that's the circumstance that we have here. So we haven't taken a position on the agency point specifically, but we think that the statute as a whole and the appropriated funds language in particular covers this court. I just wanted to address the question that was posed earlier about the legislative history of the statute. There is no indication in the legislative history of an intent to exclude law licenses. There's no indication on the text of the statute of an intention to exclude law licenses. And we are aware of no other type of professional license that's issued by or on behalf of an organ of a state that would not be covered by this statute. So our understanding.
Do you think, counsel, that your opponents, hate even to say opponents, you're a friend of the court. So, do you think that the other side's argument that we begin looking for a clear statement is correct in this context? It's preemption, right? I mean, that's the general.
Well.
Baseline.
It's a complicated question because it's an immigration statute where Congress has special powers.
Right.
And I think that our view really is that we think that the meaning of the statute is clear.
Okay.
We don't think the court needs to address the question of exactly what standard. The statute uses the term professional licenses.
Let me ask you about the appropriated funds, because that's the part that your brief focuses on. Do you think it's susceptible to the reading that one of the other counsel said, which is that, you know, what this is really about is about licenses that are provided by funds specifically appropriated to provide licenses?
There's no indication that Congress intended to hinge eligibility for licenses on the specificity of the appropriation.
But otherwise it would be a redundant statute, because entities that are funded by the state providing licenses would ordinarily just be state agencies.
We think that
maybe not exclusively, but I mean, isn't that generally so?
There will be significant overlap between appropriated funds and agency of a state. In addition to this circumstance, there are other circumstances in which it might be clearer that appropriated funds are at issue than an agency of a state. For example, if there were some non-governmental entity that had a contract through which it could provide appropriated funds. So we don't deny that there might be significant overlap between the use of appropriated funds and the agency of a state language, but that only underscores that Congress was trying to be comprehensive here. And given that the language, it seems to be indisputably covers every other state-affiliated license, grant, benefit, contract, loan that anybody can think of, our position is that this language was not a means of carving out law licenses, but rather was Congress's attempt to be comprehensive.
What about situations, I mean, suppose a license was granted by private entities, right, non-state funded entity for a certain business or profession. If a dispute arose as to the granting of the license pursuant to contract dispute or something else, and a court had to intervene to interpret terms, do you think that would be covered by this language?
I don't want to go too far on the hypothetical, but certainly
I just want to know how far it goes.
That would be an implication of our position, because in that circumstance, as I'm understanding the question, the license is provided by some other entity, other than a state agency and other than through appropriated funds, and then this court is simply enforcing the terms of that license or construing the terms of that license. That's a very different situation from the one that we're urging here, which is where the court itself is issuing, or in the words of the statute, providing.
It is different. It is different in certain respects, but it is also an availment, right? It is an availment of the instruments of the states. It's an availment of public resources. It's an availment of the taxpayer-funded instruments of the state. I mean, the state is omnipresent in that respect, right? And so you can't really have a regime in which a person is getting licenses or getting other kinds of available benefits solely privately. I mean, if you concede that enforcement through state-funded institutions is available to an undocumented immigrant, that's not that far away from this case.
Well, it's far away in the relevant respect, which is that...
I mean, here we have a state bar entity that is privately funded. Nobody disagrees with that. And it's just that the last step of the conferral, the certificate, I have one on my wall, says the Supreme Court of California, right? But most of the work and the inquiry, assessment of the applicant has been done by a privately funded entity.
The language that Congress used and the step of the process that Congress focused on was provided by. And there's no dispute that the entity that's providing the license, regardless of the invaluable role that the Bar Committee does in some of the prerequisites, the entity that's providing the license is this court. And this court is funded by appropriations. And that is the inquiry upon which Congress focused. And so this court need not reach questions of if a private entity is providing a license and then the state is involved in some other way. This case involves a circumstance in which this court is providing the license, and the words of the statute talk about provided by. And so that is as far as our argument needs to go in order for this case to be resolved.
Mr. Tenney, can I ask you a question about the opposite of your argument? And that is looking at C1, A, and B. They both contain what a public benefit is, and they both contain those sections provided by an agency or appropriated by state funds. They both say these public benefits are prohibited if they are provided by an agency or they are by an appropriated state fund. So if we believe the argument and hold the argument true that this agency of a state language does not cover the Supreme Court and appropriated funds of a state also do not cover a court, but let's just take agency, that's a simpler one. In that situation, if the agency of a state does not mean the Supreme Court, then that means, by logical consequence, that the Supreme Court can now then provide a grant or a contract or a loan or retirement benefits, welfare benefits, health benefits to undocumented immigrants. Because if you take us out of that statute and say that it doesn't mean us, then that means to me that we would be able to provide those benefits. Is that an accurate reading of the extension of that argument?
I don't want to characterize the position of my colleagues here. I do think that is a problematic feature of the reasoning on the other side. I presume that the question would then be, according to I'm not endorsing this position, but the question would be, well, maybe at some point you would say that those were appropriated funds, but our point simply is that the statute does speak of appropriated funds. It doesn't speak of specific appropriations. It doesn't speak of an amount of appropriations. And so we think that Your Honor is correct to read the whole thing together and say this court, because it's funded by appropriations, if it is providing one of the benefits listed here, then it is covered by the statute.
Well, and it also seems to me that if we were to look at the argument that appropriated funds means funds specifically appropriated for funds to provide the license, then we'd have to go to the Budget Act of the California state government and look up all the line items and see where and what wasn't specifically line item appropriated.
We don't think it's a plausible reading to say that the appropriation needs to be specific in some respect. If there was a general appropriation and an agency wanted to use that appropriation to provide benefits to unlawfully present aliens, we think it's clear that Congress did not intend to authorize that. So we agree that the specificity of the appropriation is not relevant. Unless there are any further questions, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Tenney.
Thank you, Your Honor. 1621C cannot strip this court of its core function. That's admission and discipline, not contracts, not grants. Its core function, unless it does so in clear and unmistakable language. Look at the statute. It doesn't say all professional licenses are covered. It says, one, they're only covered if it's issued by, it's provided by agencies. This court is not an agency. Congress could have easily added the terms to make it clear and manifest by an agency or of a court. It did not do so. So we come down to finding the clear and manifest language only in the appropriation language. That somehow, because this court gets funding, therefore, we can go to first base vis-a-vis right field. Because it gets funding, it's clear and manifest. May I suggest, Your Honor, the overhead salary theory is not a clear and manifest deprivation of this court's core function. So, Your Honor, as to contracts and grants, that's not the core function that's subject to this rule.
Well, let me ask you this question.
Yes,
it has been addressed before, but I'd like to hear it. What would the rationale be for Congress to exclude law licenses from all other licenses?
An excellent question, Your Honor, because Congress may well have been aware, with no legislative history we don't know, being lawyers, the power to provide a license does not come from the legislature.
But
it comes from courts.
But what would their policy reason be for excluding law licenses from everything else?
The same reason, Your Honor, that underlies the limits on preemption. That is, Congress could have said we're not going to interfere with that core function, that one. And, Your Honor, it brings me to 1621D. That gaping hole, the oddity of saying that law licenses are covered somehow by C, if you accept that this going to right.
Can
field
I ask
first.
You?
Yes.
I'm familiar with the D argument,
okay.
But the C argument. Do you know how the California Medical Board is funded?
I don't, Your Honor. But I do know that some agencies pay for licenses.
Yes, okay. So would it matter to you whether or not, I mean, the California Medical Board licenses physicians. It also does a lot of other things. It investigates complaints. It provides information to consumers. It does, you know. Would it matter to you if the California Medical Board just got a general appropriation and then it decided within its own discretion how it's going to divvy up that appropriated money, some to the licensing function, some to the investigation function, some to the consumer information function?
Under this statute, Your Honor, it wouldn't because agencies are already covered. So if agencies are covered, we don't have to worry about appropriations. What a weird redundancy. What a strange way of getting there to say that agencies which are appropriated are somehow also covered by D.
Would it matter to you if the California Medical Board were a private organization, then, that operated on contract with the state?
To the extent I think that's what subdivision C appropriation is dealing with.
Why? I mean, this is my question, is okay. if the function of the appropriation is not specifically earmarked to licensure, wouldn't that still be covered?
That's an argument that's been made, Your Honor, but I... May I?
That goes to the overhead
answer,
theory.
You may answer the question, wrap up, and then your time is
done. I will do so, Your Honor. The policy underlying this statute does not apply to law licenses because Congress did not expressly apply it to law licenses. And, Your Honor, this court certainly can issue a single decision here that says in this state there will be no per se exclusions based on this particular category, as this court has done for 50 years in making sure that individual characteristics are not a bar. We get judged on the merits of each individual application, not on the basis of our characteristics. Thank you, Your Honor.
Thank you, Mr. Wagstaff. Thank you, counsel. Matter submitted.